Is there a theme for it?
Well, I don't put it on. Oh, it's just chat wrestling. It's usually just a catch-up that we do. Just because it's been... Well, I was looking at January 2021 was the last time we had a chat.
Really,
But yeah, so that was last... Well, last time we obviously did this, of course. But we have done the old Twitter DMs, usually about silly stuff that's happening in wrestling. Yeah, so I'm recording now. Will I edit this out? I don't know. We'll find out when we get there. Right, so... Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. This one is presented by Manscaped. No one won't tell you how to trim your pubes. Well, I might later, but it'll be myself doing it. Don't you worry, people. We won't miss out on that moneymaker. I am joined with a returning guest from way back in Season 2, Episode 28 of Season 2, to be exact. It is the high-flying, death-defying Scottish luchador himself, Clyde Valley Wrestling, Lanarkshire champion. It's Lucha DS. Welcome back.
How you doing, mate? All good? I've been doing well.
It's been great. Last time we spoke, it was still like pandemic side of things.
I think we were still waiting on things to start opening up a wee bit. I think we maybe had a word of shows maybe coming back and stuff, and then they came back and it was amazing. I was everywhere, but it was no due to like a persistent annoyance of promotions and promoters all over the UK, as I like to do.
I like that you're one of the only people that contact me to check my to make sure my calendar's up to date on the website, to make sure that I've got all the shows in, and most of the time it's day, because I forget a lot of the time. A lot of the Target ones I forget, because I'm like, oh yeah, I've got a show coming up, cool, and then 5 minutes later I'll go, oh, totally forgot. I don't know when that show is, and when they put out match announcements, it's like, oh shit, they've got a show on, I'm put out my calendar.
The trick is noon again, I'll get the odd weekend where I'm maybe working, then I get it off. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, I wonder what's open that weekend. But your page, the two always hits, your page and hashtag wrestling events. Mm-hmm. But I don't know what's happening to that guy. He's dropped off big time, man. I don't think he's updated it this year. He used to be involved with promotion. I don't even know who does it.
I think he's a ring announcer. He was a ring announcer somewhere. I don't know if he still is, but I don't know if that was actually paying him money and the website wasn't. Because hashtag, I never had deals with hashtag, but they're always kind of, when I was doing stuff for Wrestle Ropes, I always felt like they were the competitor. I'd try and get the results out before hashtag did. And I was, but you know, neither of us.
I never clicked on them for a result, but the events page, because obviously they've done UK wide.
Mm-hmm.
They used to like all your obscure ones as well, so it'd be like three initials, and you're like, I've never heard this company. So you'd end up spending more time having to research what the three initials were than what the actual event was. But your wee one, I've always got saved on my wee Twitter line, because I'm always like, who's on this weekend, or where can I hit up and see if there's anything interesting coming up in the next few months that I can try and get on. But my daddy's, I'm as busy now as what I was last year already. It doesn't seem like it, because I've only done one show so far this year, but see that January gap, it's absolutely brutal. I've literally booked up to December, with dates all over the place, but there is still a few wee ones that are creeped up where I've got nothing on. I've had a wee look at your list, and there was, so here's my rant, right? This is how we'll start it. I'll have them on every promoter in Scotland, right? Talk to each other. There is weekends where there's three or four of you running the same weekend in the same not areas, but you'll run maybe shows across the same weekend, and then there's two or three weekends where there's zero wrestling on in Scotland. Like, absolutely insane. Like, I think there's like three shows this weekend. Girdles, Reckless, and Target, I think, were all this weekend.
That's the three that I've got, yeah. And Discovery, it was the Friday.
And then, I'm not entirely sure, but I think next weekend, next Saturday, there's no wrestling shows, the 11th.
Hang on.
I think there's maybe one.
I can double check my own calendar.
I'm off on the 11th.
I've got nothing on my calendar anyway.
Nobody's running. So why did, if one of them wins, because obviously, say competing with Disco, you're competing on a show that's close to Hawaii. Like, you're not going to outsell that show. So I would have run another weekend. I'd have run next weekend, and there's no wrestling. And there's a weekend in March where there's nothing on. And the weekend before, there's four shows. And the weekend after, there's four shows. Just talk to each other, guys.
Why is nobody doing a Valentine's themed show next weekend? That's just an open goal.
Next weekend.
Because Monday's Valentine's Day. It's 14th. So
a lot of wrestling fans don't have significant others.
Well, that means that
neither do a lot of wrestlers.
They sell a lot of single tickets, so it'd be fine.
You need a speed dating wrestling show where there the fans sit beside a fan and every match they have to switch. There you go.
God, that sounds like my idea of hell, to be honest. But you know, it could work.
Yeah, but your page for dates has been really good. It's been good for plugging your odd wee gap where I've had something coming up. Because you can follow all the promotions pages. I say this to trainees all the time. I don't just mean trainees at PBW, SW. I mean like every promotion wrestler should be following every company, whether you're booked for them or not, because you need to know who's working where, who's where on cards and where shows are running, because you kind of just dip in and out. If you're going to be involved, you need to be involved in all of it. Then you've got the likes of guys like Zero. Like, Mad Zero is at 20 plus shows, constant helping out and things. That's why he's getting places where he is, through graft, no? Then you get other guys that are complaining about not getting spots on shows, and there's people that are outworking you. And if I was running a show, I would put you guys when you come on, help out, share stuff on social media. So it's a no-brainer to me.
Then you got guys like Hugo Harris, who I just saw for the first time December, and Ian O'Raw. Of course, they're always, it's Kiba Lee as well, they're always plugging, they're doing Mega Slam, and they're going to these weird and wonderful places that are just out of,
yeah,
in the middle of nowhere, and they're still every weekend they've got like three shows on, and that's just it's...
Hugo should be everywhere. Hugo is amazing, and he's also jacked, and he looks like an action figure, and you can put him on any poster, and you're gonna get your mum's attention, though. And Hugo, I think I was on a show with Hugo last year. I was on a show, and Hugo hadn't wrestled. Faye coming back, and I went in the dressing room and he was getting ready, and I said to the promoter, "Who's that boy?" And he said, "Oh, it's Hugo." And I was like, "I've never been on a show with him before." And within 5 minutes I'd sat and talking to him, and I said to, I think it was Ace Anderson, I was like, "That boy's going to be everywhere. Like, look at the nick he's in." I watched his match, he was really good in the match as well, and I said, "Why have I never heard this boy?" And then I think I gave his name to Big Massive and somewhere else, and the two shows used them, and now look at him, he's done maybe about 20 shows already this year, and he will be everywhere. He's on the upcoming PBW, he's one half of the Big Massive Wrestling Tag Team Champions, he's on the SWE shows. Like, the guy's just getting after it, and then he'll follow along the lines. I would like to think of like Jack Morris, who is where Japan just now, absolutely killing it. Again, looks like an action figure, but is it having like that? So Hugo, I'm actually a big fan of Hugo. Yeah, I've still not had my singles match with him. When I won the Clyde Valley belt, it was against him and Jackal in a triple threat. But Hugo's on the ball. He knows what he's doing. So fair play him.
It's just one of those things. I mean, we're not going to dive into negative, but it is some of the places that maybe he's popping up of don't have maybe as good a reputation to move on to other companies, and you know, it's just one of those things that's possibly maybe holding them back. But you know, if he's good enough, then he'll get to these places.
People get a bit hung up on what companies you're working for and what you're not working for. The talent is a talent. The best guys for the best companies work everywhere. I know there's this kind of gripe, like the whole SWE, FCW, this outside the Glasgow Central Belt thing, and there was a kind of wee hint here with the WrestleZone guys with the Bobby Roberts stuff last week, but the best guys work everywhere. The boys for WrestleZone are doing it Disco, they were doing it Pro 2. I think that was the show that was cancelled, but I was to wrestle one of the boys for, I can't remember what they're called, the Trios boys,
Foundation guys.
Three cranking wrestlers. But the best talent on whatever promotion will work everywhere. People don't get too stuck in your wee bubble. You need to do it in your comfort zone, because that's where you learn. That's where you go and earn your stripes, as you say. Where you work against these, you work against really good guys. You work against really terrible guys. But that's where you earn your stripes, because if you want to be one of them guys who they say could get a match at a broom, then you need to wrestle a couple of brooms to know how to do it.
That's right. I mean, I've always thought for yourself anyway that you're just a guy that doesn't really let the all that kind of stuff just doesn't enter your mind. You're just there to you're there for 20 minutes. You want to wrestle. You want to do a good wrestling match, and then go home.
I could not care less. I don't care what your initials are above the door. I don't care what your promotion is. I don't care who you like, who you don't like, who you once were best pals with, who you dislike now, who you are forever anyway, who's got OnlyFans, who's got this, who's got that. I don't care. I show up, put my mask on, go and do my match, go to the merch table, meet and greet a couple of fans, then I'm up the road. That's it. And that's if everybody else concentrated on doing the job and going home and not getting caught up in all the other part of it. Some dressing rooms would be a nicer place. But the biggest thing, most of all that stuff, see all the gripes and all that, 9 times out of 10, it's not even the talent. It's the people who own the company, the promoter. Yeah. They got hung up over a poster getting ripped down or whatever. Put another poster up, he's getting like 10,000 in your order. Paper replacing posters, like, you could say the same thing with, like, say, the Fairground people. They will annihilate your posters. They will cover them, like, to get caught up with, like I said, not go down that rabbit hole, but most of all the gripes and the moans are between the people running the shows. It's not a talent. Like, the big time scene, there was SWE, FCW, were complaining about each other, fire alarms being set off, posters and ripped in.
Sorry, allegedly. Allegedly, let's throw that word in there.
Allegedly, not me. But the two groups of talent on each show, we were messaging each other laughing about it. Like, it's like we're going, oh, I can't believe it. Like, I think I was messaging Luke King Sharp. I was on SW, Luke King Sharp was on FCW, and I messaged him, mate, we were outside, it was freezing, blah 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 blah. But there's no heat between the talent. I think the promoters like to think it's there's an us and them, and it's not. It's us and yous guys, the guys that pay the wage.
I know. Well, again, this is all just from my side the barrier, of course. But yeah, it's a lot of the impression of as long as you pay me, I will do my job. But sometimes it is like I don't want to work for you because I've heard you've done this, and maybe that's just your compass at the end of the day. It just depends what you want to do. I'm sure if there was some wrong-in that was running a show, and you'd be like, nah, I don't really want to work for you, but you know,
exactly.
But so yeah, it's just your own moral compass at the end of the day. But let's get back to your wrestling. Let's not talk about all that shite, because you know it's a rabbit hole we could dive down and probably have cease and desist written on poorly printed paper at the end of the day.
Well, if any promoter wants to cease and desist with me, just send out my email, where it'll be soundly thrown in the recycle bin.
I will make a petty T-shirt on T-mail. That's what I'll do if you send a season. right, okay. So let's go back to where we were. So January 2021 is when we last had our chat, and like a couple months after that, you were on the WWE Network. I think it was June that came out, the match you had with Talon Jr. against Alex Parker and Logan Smith. So at this point, it would be one of your first matches or first couple matches back at that point, and it's going on the biggest wrestling network, arguably, in the world.
And it's absolute shite. The match is honking. I was totally the wrong guy to use, to show up in an empty warehouse where there's two camera guys. My whole wrestling persona is interaction with the fans. There was nobody to interact with. And that match is on the network was actually the second match. I had a singles match before it with Logan, and it's a banger. Absolute, I love it match. But it wasn't used. I don't know. It wasn't telling the story or whatever way they put the episodes. So you've got the second match, which is off the back of the singles match, where, to be honest, like, I hate it much. I've never watched it back. Logan likes to wind me up that I'm on the network. I'm on it. I would have loved to have the singles match to go up, because I think me and Logan leathered each other in that match, and I really enjoyed it. But it's on there. I can now say I'm as seen on WWE Network, but
exactly. That's a little on the poster.
I've not seen it.
It's still a cool achievement to have. Maybe now that ICW are not on the network anymore going forward, they'll have like a wee hidden gems thing that they'll put some of their unaired matches into, and that'll get on there.
That tag match ain't going to be on any sort of list. It's on the list of don't watch. The only thing I take from it is cool is my wee boy can go on the network, put in my wrestling name, and a match comes up. So that's cool. That's cool for him. But I think I said to him as well, like, don't watch that match. It's rubbish. not because the talent or anything involved. The actual structure of the match that I was kind of happy with. It was the WWE product, the AEW product, and other wrestling products when there was no fans, to me, isn't wrestling.
Mm-hmm.
It's because the whole point is to do something to get a reaction. Because I know you've done the video screen thing.
No, the Thunderdome.
At least they tried. They tried to get some sort of interaction as much as they were choreographing it and all that stuff. But to wrestle in front of anybody wasn't wrestling to me. It was effectively training. It was like a training match. And my gear. It was good to get kind of cobwebs off a wee bit, get back in the ring, and feel that I was doing something, been a bit productive. Plus, it was a bit of cash as well, because wages for that were good as well. But to me, I was like, it's not it. No, I mean,
so,
I never made a
Ruler
Ruud comparison. I don't know, mate, but it's not the same.
I think I know what you're going for. I think I can imagine what your comparison you're going for.
It's the same. You either do something yourself or you do it for somebody else. There's a huge difference, isn't there?
Exactly. Yeah. That's it. Speaking of, we're sponsored by Mask MMA. Anyway. So we got that. You got your ICW. Your quote unquote debut, because it was your second match, and wasn't there for you. But like I say, got the cobwebs shook off. Next one I've got in my notes here is November for Pro 2, your debut at Pro 2. Back to the Thunderdome. Yeah, I think we did the DM about it. It was weird. And now that it's even weirder to think I got booted out for booing Sasha Banks, and you know, I don't think they would mind if I booed her now, to be honest, after all that.
I don't get that whole, all the reactions need to be the same. You don't want everybody cheering your bad guy, booing your bad guy. Is it the whole conflict is with as an audience? Like, if you just wanted everybody else sitting clapping, it'd be like, I know compared to like Japanese audience, but not the like happy clappy or like a golf clap.
Mm-hmm.
You want a kind of genuine reaction. The same way that when you go to the FIPA, you'll get somebody like a player will do something and somebody will be like, he's hopeless. You're like, he's brilliant. Like, is that contrast of feedback that generates a noise? It was just a bizarre time in wrestling that hopefully never happens again.
No, fingers crossed. Pro 2 then. So you made a debut in there in November of 2021 with Adam Shame, which I'm going to guess if the matches with ICW didn't shake the cobwebs off, match with Shamer would have, for sure.
I actually thought that wasn't my debut, but was it? Do you know what? That was my debut.
Yeah.
It was, wasn't it? So, wee story about that. So, I was on a show the day before, and the person who was to wrestle Shamer got injured, and I was sitting backstage with him, and I could see they were hot. And he must have just messaged the promoter and said, I'm hot, I'll not be able to wrestle tomorrow. And then my phone went, and it was the same promoter as me. Like, is you available? I said, yeah, I'm available. And so that's when I jumped in and done that match.
Was that the one at Bounce Station? Was that the one at the Bouncy Castle place?
No, that was in Ambank. The first Bounce Station one I wrestled, Zero.
Right.
And at Bounce Station show, that is something else, by the way. See that for a venue. The photographs and the video at the time didn't do it justice of how enclosed we corner is of that inflatables place, because they had to deflate everything, wrote all the way, then the ring comes in, then we put all the chairs around it, and the way the fans are queued and the weather outside, so the fans actually watched the ring getting built and stuff. It kind of added to the atmosphere because of the the kind of anticipation. All the kids were all bouncing, and literally, and then when the show started, the crowd were noisy as. But that one with Adam Shane, that was a great rematch. One, because I wasn't meant to be on the show, and it was our first time singles with Shamer, which was a pop. To be second for any, it's quite a switch here. Laptop's going to die, or I had to turn back on. Me and Shamer had a really fun match. Shamer's a genuine veteran. He's been about for forever in the Scottish scene. So to get in a ring with him and kind of bounce your ideas off him of what you're what to do and what he's what to do, there was a kind of good contrast of, and we put loads of comedy in it as well, which is always a good laugh, especially on a family show, when you can. I think I kicked him up the arse about 6 times, and he kept rubbing his bum and shouting my biscuits, and like it was popping me, it was popping the ref. And I mean, you know something's funny if the guy doing the move to you is trying not to laugh, so the crowd don't see that I've busted.
But I mean, that's it. Have you found that since like first coming back that there's been a lot more an influx of talent coming through, and are you finding your opponents now are a bit more varied? Everyone's doing a little bit something different now, or was it kind of back to the status quo when the shows restarted?
It goes through cycles. Like you'll get it where like a new school will open somewhere, and you'll get like a rush of kind of 3 or 4 or 5 guys who'll come at it, and then they start going everywhere. Like, I'd put it back to like a time when, remember when the Asylum first opened, when you directs like the original intake, so you'd do Crowbar and Stevie James, what were they called?
The Purge. Charge.
So you had the Purge, and then you had the guy Rose.
Yes, yes, Rose. Yeah.
CS Rose. Sam Barber.
Kez Evans, I think. He was doing about the first
one. Kez was one of the originals as well. So you got them guys, and then next thing they kind of start appearing everywhere, and then another school, and then you get another crop for that guys, and then you'll get like it was kind of run about the time when the Asylum came, when that opened. Source has always had a good crop of guys. PBW had a good crop of guys, the Asylum guys, and then we've done the Invitational, where we've all done the tournament.
Of course, yeah.
And then that was to continue the run, and whatever happened, it didn't go ahead. And then they done the other one, then they brought the wild card in, the boy for WrestleZone came down, was part of it. So like you get these cycles, and then just now you've got Andy Wild School. So you've got like Daisy, Tommy Cartel, who's the other guy? Talon. No, like, so you've got another wee crop coming through, and I imagine again probably next year you'll get another crop from somewhere else, or a current group of trainees that are really doing well and busting through. And then it's just a matter of hopefully the promotion uses these people, because when the Asylum opened, we hit just before that, it was very closed shop. Who was you wrestle here? They're their guys. They're the Reckless guys. They're the SWA guys. And everybody's kind of stayed in their bubble. And then when that all started amalgamating a bit better, and we all started to mix and thing with, I think the scene improved, because one, we were all having to wrestle each other, but also there was an air of competition to it. You didn't want to be on a show when a sound guy and suck. Or yeah. Like me and Soldato were doing it was Wrestle Experience Scotland, but at the time it was called something else. I can't remember what they called it.
5 minute wrestling, was it, or something like that?
No, it was 5 Pound Wrestling was the thing they done in Denny. That was like their trainee show. I can't remember what it was, but me and Soldato tagged and done like a run a show with the Purge. And when I was showing up, I was like I might have been the only one who wasn't one of their guys on that show. So one, like I wanted to make sure I was professional, I was there on time, I was doing shaking everybody's hand, introduced myself, helping with a ring. And then it was the same when like Leighton Buzzard was coming through at PBW, he was coming through doing ring announcing, helping with the ring. Like, so everybody was all mucking in to not to stand out, but to make sure you were doing a good job when you were showing up at these other promotions, and then it only adds to it. So if I get a call saying like there's a show in Sunderland for whatever promotion, when I go down, I now know when I show up, I do this, I do that, I do this, I do that, and it's ingrained in me. It's not just for show. It's an actual culture of that's how I behave at a show, and that was the thing that came through. So you all the Asylum guys, all the PBW guys, all the Source guys, the Reckless guys, the WrestleZone guys, all these guys, bringing through the next crop, and we were all working together. That it's took a wee step back since COVID.
Mm-hmm.
But that's met the day we. I think it's a financial thing. Do you know how much it is to like for like a KFNS? See, petrol money for KFNS is extortionate just now.
Mm-hmm.
We've got two cars going up, so that guy has to fill more or less a quarter of that room just to cover the cost of that. You know what I mean? And then not to say the cost of his own venue, cost of his own guys. So people have been a wee bit more
cautious, yeah, a bit cautious of booking outside.
I was going to say tight.
I was putting a positive spin on it there, but
as for us, that's just the real effect of what's going on in the world. The good thing is the shows are still running, fans are still coming out, and live entertainment never really gets affected by these things. The only thing that's affected is the costs. People will trim costs. You'll notice that posters aren't putting four or five big name guys on it anymore. You'll get one or two. There'll be more trainees that'll keep through, but that's a positive for people who are coming through training, because you go, I've got a chance of going on that show. Where did you see before? You would look at a post and you go, how am I going to go on it? Like, you'd have BT Gunn, Stevie Xavier, Wolfgang, Jack Jester, and Grado on a poster, Liam Thompson. You're going, where do I fit in that?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm so far down that ladder. Now I'd like to think there's a poster, I'm on it. But back that day, like, it wasn't a closed shop, but the mountain just seemed too high to climb. Whereas, you know, the amount of talent coming through, how well trained the people coming through are as well. People are coming on to shows and like you've got like a like trying to that last ICW show. Daz Black, Kez Evans, Leighton Buzzard, Stevie James, Krieger, Lou, like that's this generation now. And that's all guys that I came up with. So I look at it as like that's my era. Are now the main event guys for 10 promotions across Scotland. So that's as much as it's moving slowly, it's moving in a really positive way, I think. But then when you mention Shamer, like he's the older generation guys, there's definitely a place for him on shows like your Andy Wild, Andy Roberts, Bobby Roberts.
Everyone shows for him.
Mate, Bobby will be back. I'm telling you. Do you know our wrestling business? How many people you seen retire?
Oh, aye.
And then next thing, they're like, oh, I'm back. It seems this year will be interesting purely because there's more promotions. There's too many promotions. I nearly done a joke tweet that there was more promotions in Scotland than wrestlers. And the number's only going to go up. I know it because I've got bookings for shows that haven't even been announced. for promotions that haven't even declared themselves as a promotion yet. This year will be busy because these shows are going to need talent on them. And I can't wrestle everywhere. I want to, but I physically can't. If you're doing three shows on a weekend with pre-promotions running at the same time, like, I can't do them all. There's too many miles in between, so there's spaces for everybody.
But speaking of like name too many promotions, but having like one or two big names on, I think for as much as WWE got a lot of flack for like for quote unquote stripping the indie scene of all the big names and then like leaving it to dust, but now because of things like the WWE Network and having Progress on it and ICW on it. These are your big names. You can put Daz Black on a poster, put As Seen on the WWE Network. Folk are going to go, WWE. Okay, we'll go to that show because this guy was on it. So, yeah, like you're saying, it is moving in a positive direction. It's just trying to figure out from
there. Daz Black should be on every poster. Daz Black is he's the money just now. He's the man. It's astonishing he has not signed somewhere just now. See if you're a trainee coming through, right, and you're looking at the wrestling scene and going, I want to one day wrestle for WWE, which I've never wanted to do. It's never been my thing. One, because it's not that I didn't think it was an achievable goal. I just went, I'm too old to be jumping over to America, blah, blah, blah. Not ever happened, but Daz Black looks amazing. Can do things that 99% of wrestlers on the scene can do. He's photographic, athletic as, flippy as, like he is the prime example of what a talent should be aiming to be. And he's doing that here. He's everywhere just now. But the fact that he's not signed up to somewhere would be, if I was a trainee coming through, you're like, what do I need to do to achieve that goal? Especially see with this NXT UK thing and all that kind of been knocked on heat just now. Until a sale happens, it's, you're going, where is Matt in? Like AEW don't seem to be bringing UK talent over very often. Then WWE, obviously, have got the guys they've took for the indie scenes here. And then they got rid of half of them guys. So you guys are all back here looking to get back onto the scene as well, no? So a trainee coming through now, if Daz Black kind of gets signed through, can. It's insane.
NXT Europe is supposed to be a thing this year, so maybe that'll be the catalyst for quite a few folk like Daz and Leighton and all that kind of names getting a foothold into somewhere.
The guys in the scene know roughly who the next crop were to go, because obviously you know what's, we all hear about it, who's going behind the scenes, but the fact that I was stopped is if I was involved in like Impact or AEW, or that, I'd be like, who if they let slip through this net and who can we take? Daz Black, Angel Hayes, Jack Morris. I mean, Jack's obviously signed it more, but there's a crop of guys that I would scoop up and put on retainer. And even if you just want them to buy your contract out, you could just use it as like an investment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, Jason Reed be another one just popped off the top of my head there going, The boy's just, he's so good. Hi guys, it's ad time here on the SWN podcast. Very first time I've got to do an ad read, so I'm very excited for this. Support for the SWN podcast is brought to you by Manscaped, who is the best in men's below-the-waist grooming. Their products are precision-engineered tools for your family jewels. Hopefully next week I should have a package containing Manscaped's performance package, the ultimate men's hygiene bundle. And I'll be able to talk about that a little bit more. I'm very excited for it. They're sending me a box with loads of cool gadgets and stuff that I can test out. And I won't show you, but I'll tell you how it goes. Join over 7 million men worldwide who trust Manscaped with this exclusive offer just for you guys. 20% off and free worldwide shipping with the code SWN20. Should be below if you're watching on the video. Should be somewhere in the description if you're listening to audio. Now you go to manscaped.com, SWN20. You put in that code, 20% off and free worldwide shipping. 7 million men worldwide. So by my math, that's 14 million balls, approximately, you know, give or take. Get 20% off and free shipping with the code SWN20 at manscaped.com. That's 20% off with free shipping at manscaped.com. Don't know if I've said that enough. And use code SWN20. Unlock your confidence and always use the right tools for the job with Manscaped. Right, back to you, though. We're very good at tangents, going off into tangents. That's not changed on the podcast since you've been on previously. I just kind of wander off into other topics and then somehow I drag it back into some sort of order. I was going to talk about the Final Respect Pro Wrestling Show, but it seems like a silly subject now.
Let's talk about it. I was one of my favourite matches that year. Me, Siki, been looking sharp. I think there was like six belts on the line.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah, no, that was a crazy, crazy match. And the fact that the three of us were buckled backstage, there were so many wrestlers on that show, and backstage are respected two big dressing rooms. We couldn't even get in a dressing room, so we just, I think we'd all been on a show that day. We'd all went from somewhere to there. I was at Pro 2, and then I'm right up at Respect, so I'd still had my gear on. And I think we were on early as well, so that was one of my favourite matches. The three of us went out, we've all wrestled each other 20-odd times, so we kind of done it like a compilation mixtape, like me and Sakiba going, remember that time we done that? We'll do that. Me and Lou were like, remember that bit we done there? It was funny, we'll do that. And then Sakiba and Lou were like, we'll do that bit for that bit, and it was kind of like a greatest hits match. I love that match, it's amazing to go out and actually, like, again, have a laugh and put on. I always like him. My match is one of the best anyway, but on that card, that match with us three, I don't know if it could have been that night. It was amazing.
It sounded like a good night. I was seeing the results, of course, because I wasn't at the show because, you know, Crane's card and all that. But yeah, I could get to the show, but I was seeing the results pop up, and it just sounded like a good laugh, and just a little bit of a nice bookend to respect. I think they'd all been running for what, three, 4 years, something like that. If you take out the pandemic, but.
And they had good shows. But I would now and again get a message from Bobby at Rannick just saying there's a show on this date, and then he would follow up with who do you want to work. So a lot of times I would be picking my opponent. So that's how a lot of times at Respect you would see me going, it's a first time match. Because I'd be going, I want to wrestle somebody I've not wrestled. I think that's how I wrestled Jason Reeder. Who else did I wrestle? Darren Weiss. I wrestled him. He's not a bit anymore. I wrestled him on like a camp show. But a lot of first time matches would happen there because Bobby would say to me, who do I work? So I could kind of pick my opponent.
After he said no to The Rock and all that kind of stuff, you eventually settled on some of the guys around here.
I'll wrestle Zero. Respect was good. It's a good wee area as well. Obviously, new Pro Tours down there. The Ayrshire crowds are brilliant. And they deserve good shows as well. So hopefully Pro 2 can pick up where that kind of wee void is. I know wrestling has been in Scotland up there too. So Ayrshire's a really good wee market.
So I think there's nice, a lot of places are starting to realise that maybe there is space, not on this, obviously on the same weekend or on the same month possibly, but there is kind of a bit of space, a bit of wiggle room to have a couple of promotions around the same markets, as long as there's a good gap in between, so you're not digging into each other's profit margin at the end of it. But it's just good for us as fans, really, because we're getting to get all this wrestling.
Exactly.
So I mean, again, this side of the barrier, I'm not. Oh, dropped the mic there. This side of the barrier, I'm not really thinking about the promoter's profit margin. I just want to go to a show that's affordable and watch some good wrestling.
That's all we should be worrying about. It's good matches on good shows. That's it. And making sure that another one, like making sure the venues are all right. Like, don't want to wrestle like some dilapidated building. Like you're going, this building's been held up with sellotape. There's no heating in it. There's like the pick and mix of chairs of like the chairs don't even match. Like you get adult chairs and baby chairs beside you. it just makes the product look rubbish as well.
That's it. I mean, I'm no OCD by any stretch of the imagination, but if I walked into a venue and there's mismatched chairs all over the place, I would be on edge the whole night going, if they haven't organised the chairs, I don't trust them to organise anything else.
It's crazy. The wee things you don't think about. I've done a show once for a promotion, which I'll not name, and when we showed up, they were like, yeah, there's a hall, and there's all the chairs, and I was like, and where are we getting changed? And they're like, oh. But the thing is there was rooms for us to use. They just hadn't asked for them to be opened, so they were all locked.
Jesus.
And so that's how jump out of your car, get changed in your car, and hopefully somebody will wave to you, let you know your music's playing. Like it's not great. Because you get into a ring to do your match in a huff, no, you're like, oh. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you've got a good space backstage to get a good warm up, so like when you get through the curtain you feel like, yeah, I'm raring to go here, I'm good to go, is a big part of it.
So moving on to that though, this year, well, last year, of course, we're in 2023 now, you restarted the Lucha DS podcast. I think it's started and stopped. I don't know if it's continuing any further.
Right, well, here's your exclusive. The podcast that you see was in a space that I was using. But I'd painted all the wall, done the mural, done all the things. That venue that I was using, or area I was using, didn't have electricity. Which is hard today because obviously I need to run the laptop, the camera, and the microphones. I need to run it all off electricity. And I got some, but as getting some, I got then a letter saying that I was basically evicted for the space I was using because I shouldn't have been using it. And the means of getting electricity there weren't Correct. So once I lost that space, I'm can't be bothered with it just now. I'm just going to have a wee gap for it. We're coming into that time of year where there's no shows anyway, so I've nothing to talk about. So the kind of setup I've got here, the flag behind me, the mic and the thing with, is it might come back, but it might be just me again, the way I used to do it before, where I'd just be promoting what's coming up, what dates I've got coming up, how folk can get tickets, and I'm in the middle of trying to set up a website as well, that is just for me, but it'll be a website that will... The idea for the website is you click on the website, my logo comes up, and then underneath it's all the posters of where I'm going to be. You click on the poster, and there's each poster is a link for the tickets of the show. Okay. I'm on. Just simple clicking, cheap and cheerful. But then the idea would then put the podcast on there as well, because I used to do the one where I used to just talk. I used to use a wee Zoom recorder, and I used to love doing it. See, just the process of uploading it onto Apple and then having it put on a sound clip, like, see, just all the tech side of it was enough to put me off of doing it, because I didn't enjoy doing that part. But the actual creating it, and then the one I was doing when I was interviewing folk, because I really enjoyed the interviews of folk. In fact, I don't think I spoke to you if I'd done it, because I think I slagged you on it a couple of times.
I'm an audio listener, so when it comes to YouTube, I find it harder to kind of keep on it.
I used to have a pop at you for reviewing shows. One, because the no reviewing of, say, video shows, the promotions I've put up. I hate promotions putting matches up.
I honestly hate reviews like that. I do it because I need to fill a space, because I'm trying to like put something out each day. But you can definitely tell if I'm watching a show on YouTube or if I'm there live. There's absolute night and day difference in my reviews when I do them.
Yeah, but my issue with it, and you could even say it like that, WWE Network match. I don't like stuff getting gave away for free. Like the wrestlers are doing a show, fans are buying tickets to the show. Mm. If you're going to put something up, put highlights up, like a 2-3 minute highlight reel, because what you want to put up is an advert for people to come again. But if you're just going to put a full show up or a full matchup, people will go, why would I buy a ticket to that? If I wait 2 weeks, I can watch it for free on YouTube or Facebook or thing like. And to me, it's just bad. It's bad business. But if it's like an on-demand thing, then like if you show up and like, because W3L did it, ICW have got their own on-demand one. I can't even think who else. SW have got their own on-demand service now. If you're charging to put it on, then that's different, because you're then making an income from it. But I hate stuff being given away for free. Especially, see, if they don't tell you that they're videoing it for free, and you go, right, okay, and then you go, oh, and there's my matchup, and you're going, oh, like, not I would have done anything different, but like, I'd like to know in the back of my mind that unless it's going to go up somewhere. That was my wee gripe with that. I just, like I said, it's just bad business. If I ran my promotion, you wouldn't get in for free. You've got a 1 minute highlight reel on, and then at the end it would be the poster for the next show. Like, this is what you missed, this is what's coming up, that's all you need.
So you'd be the kind of guys that dingy me if I go, have you got the results for the show? You'd be like, ah, should have been there.
No. Results is completely different, because the first thing I do, within 10 minutes of me finishing a match, the results on my Lucha DS page, where we clip, usually the back clip entrance or something, because that advertises me, as well as an always tag a promotion in it, so the promotion gets a thing as well, but it's just business. It's like you want to create a demand for people to come, and throwing a full show on Facebook or YouTube doesn't do that. You're just burning an advert.
What I will say though, if you are putting out a show on YouTube, at least make it edited so it looks good, because there's so many I've watched. I probably have put in the reviews. Sometimes I get really salty about it. I'm a positive guy generally, but sometimes I'll watch a show and go, why have they done that? But yeah, at least edit it. So one, I can hear if you've got commentary, I want to hear it. and two, take out all the shit. Take out all the fluff. Just give me the matches, give me the entrances, give me the matches, give me the entrances, give me the post-match angle, whatever. I don't need to see the ring announcer get in the ring and do the fire safety thing. I don't need to see it. That's not part of why I'm there. So, if you're going to put out a show, edit it at least. And if you can't edit it, don't put it out.
And also, say there's a match on it, it's absolutely rotten. Edit it. Don't, because there's, especially see, you've got, like I said, if you're using trainees on your show and it's only like their fifth or sixth match, that match is going to be terrible, no matter who the trainee is. In fact, I will guarantee you, if I watch any of my first 25 matches I've ever done, I will hate every single one of them. Because the level, you're just not a sufficient level to be putting out good matches. And then I'll see, like, Rivals. Did you see that Rivals main event match?
Oh, yes, I did.
why would you post that online?
I didn't see it when it came out, but someone ripped it and sent it to me, and I watched it. I was like, why?
Well, in wrestler circles, see, the within 10 minutes of that being posted, I think I had two of my group chats and shared it to me. And I went with Jan Gast, and I said, at first I was like, I'm not watching it, like, because I wasn't on the show, and I don't know the promotion, and blah, blah, blah. Yeah. And then people were like, no, you need to watch it. And I was just like, oh, so I'm assuming something bad's going to happen, like I'm like a botch or something gets hot, or like, oh, there's got to be some. And then seeing I sat and watched that, I was just like, that's atrocious. And that wasn't put on by, that wasn't fan footage. That wasn't...
that wasn't on their Facebook page.
They promoted that match. I don't know the guy who runs the show, but alternatively, I do know some of the guys that have done the show, which is why I wouldn't slate the company. Mm-hmm. But it's that thing I always say to, like, trainees or anybody I'm training along with. If that's the product that they're putting out and advertising, and you're on the poster, that's as good as you've been in that match. Mm-hmm. Like, if that match is a bomb scare, you're part of that bomb scare, because you promoted yourself to bring people to that show, no? I don't know what that match was, but I don't know why you would put up. Even I don't think you can make a highlight with that match to make it watchable.
It was right. It's well, since all the pandemic thing, I've started to become really picky about who I feature now on the website, because it's now because of stuff like that. If it was like 2 years ago, I would have went, all right, it's a new promotion, happened in Scotland, right? I'll put a post out about it. But now I'm like, no, it has to be quality over quantity now for who I feature. Because someone, I mean, I'm not saying that, I mean, you use the calendar, so it's clear some people actually use the site for whatever reason. If I put out a show, an advertisement for a show, then and I'm as good as telling you to go, and if it's shit, then I've made the recommendation, and it's shit. So now it makes me look bad. So I have to be super picky with who I feature now because of that.
And like I said, and I don't know. Do you have a list of all Scottish promotions?
I do. I've got a list of ones we've
many's on it. How many? Just not who you feature and who you don't. Many's on that list. 30.
Right. So we feature about 14. So who's not on that list? That's the next thing. Maybe about 10. So yeah, probably about 25, something like that. I would say, just off the top of my head. Ridiculous.
So that's a lot of promotions, a lot of shows. And like I said, you're going to get your really good top quality shows, top production. Like your likes of Disco with all their lights and their entrance and stuff like that, to ones that like companies like PBW are just filling town halls of hundreds and hundreds of people. And then you've got that show that's going up. And the thing is mums and dads on the street who are going along seeing a poster are thinking that that's what that is. No? So if you take your kid along to, I'm saying Rivals, for example. Let's say I don't know the guy or anything, so I don't want people trying to give me heat out of it. But if that was the first show you took your kid to and he was like, that's rubbish, the next time there's a show nearer or another promotion coming through town, you're not going to go to it. So you've effectively burned an audience of a product that they might love.
That's the thing with also
people get annoyed by it. Like, I know particular wrestlers went after the promotion and the guy, and were posting stuff. Again, that's not what I would do. But there's a reason why people are annoyed by it. It's not just because what you're posting is rubbish or of a poor standard. It's what it is you're maybe going to turn people away from the product to could come along to a show. Like, when I first went along to a live wrestling show, like, I fell in love with it, whether it be the lights, the production, even a wee daft thing, see, the first time when I was wee and I went to a show and there was a barrier, like, stopping me touching the ring, like, that was a big deal to me. Like, I was like, oh, look at that thing, I can't even reach, I can't touch it. But the guys in there, they're the only ones that are getting to use it. That put my mind to how special that wee area was, where the ropes and that are, like, you just want it to be there and be part of it.
Mm-hmm.
It's the people are, I don't know whether it's I want to run a show because I can, or I want to run a show because I've got a ring, or I want to run a show because I want to make a couple of quid. Like, why are people doing what they're doing? And I don't always think that people are on as, like, even it could be I want to run a show because it's the only place I could do a show, like, or get used.
Mm-hmm.
It's then that thing of quality over quantity. You're going to, when you're asked to be part of that show, you're going to do it just to stroke somebody's ego, or you're doing it because is going to boost your career or make you look good, because nobody coming after that show looked good with the product that was put up after it. And like I said, it was them that was promoting it, so that's a promotion effectively damaging your reputation. It doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah, it's if we start diving into the whole that side of things, it just gets messy. And like we were saying earlier about the, like, we're now at a stage where two promotions can run the same territory. But if one promotion, like you're saying, if one promotion's garbage, then nobody's going to go to the other one, because
exactly,
they'll be burned by the first one. So it's. I mean, I've heard stories, things like what's it called? Is it EPW? Something, they run loads of shows and they just use the same crop of guys every time, and they sometimes come to towns. I've heard reviews of their shows and they're not great. But if another promotion's running there a couple of weeks later, they're actually a reputable promotion. In my opinion, anyway, and they're running that show, they're automatically going to lose at least, like, a few folk that are going to go because they went, oh, I went to see wrestling, it was shite, they're going to go to this. So,
aye, exactly. Or, like I said, with this time of year, with people are money, when money's tight, people mm-hmm. go along with that, I feel like I was ripped off. Like, that's worse. Now, going to see something that's rubbish happens, like, I've been to comedy shows where the comedian was rotten, but I didn't feel like I was robbed. Mm-hmm. No, like, if you go along and you go, I paid, you know, 15 quid for a ticket to this and it's absolute garbage. Like, I want my money back. Where's my 15 quid? Mm-hmm. I could have used that 15 quid for my electricity, my gas.
Exactly. It's now, nowadays, that however you're pricing your tickets at, that is the most important, whatever, £15 that you're getting in, because if you don't perform for that 15 quid, however, multiply it how many times, you're not getting it back next time. You're not getting it the next show. So it's, you have to earn every single penny now, and because of this cost of, like you say, live events don't often get affected, but they still do. They're still a special thing.
My thing as well is my time's really precious to me. So if you're going to take 2 hours of my time, you need to entertain me.
That's it. I mean, well, for me now, for going to wrestling, I've got to organise a baby. But organised babysitting, the dog has to be looked after as well, because we're going away for a few hours, because no wrestling in Elgin except once a year, twice a year if we're lucky.
Who's that,
W3L? W3L, yeah, they're done here. Yeah. They're from here. They won twice last year, which was a nice wee thrill. So yeah, otherwise it's an hour and a half either side if it's Inverness or Aberdeen if I'm going to wrestling. So that's a lot to organise there and back, and
yeah,
you don't realise how much it is for that £15 ticket, how much you have to organise around it. And if you go to a show and it's absolute shit, you're like, well, I'm not bothering, because that's 10 hours of my life that I've spent organizing all this shit.
Exactly.
Show, and then
it's time you kind of get back. So, mm-hmm. especially you've got a wedding that now as well. Mm-hmm. You're going, oh, I'm going to spend 10 hours away from my wedding to watch these two idiots roll about. Or am I going to go and actually be entertained and feel like I've like gave myself a bit of enjoyment for a couple of hours? I mean, that's what I'm saying.
Exactly. Right, so we've got you hit over 300 matches last year in total. So what is your next kind of milestone? Is it just every 100, 400, 500? What's your kind of next big milestone?
To be honest, I don't think I'll hit 500 Just time wise, last year was 74 shows I've done. So if this year's as busy, another 74 would take you into like 2025 to 400. I'm being a wee bit pernickety as well with some of my dates that I'm taking for, like, in England and stuff. Not because I don't like the promotions, I don't like the matches or anything I've been offered. Again, it's just that time. Like, it's such a slog going down to England. Like, you're effectively right now 2 days, or maybe three, because you've got to prep everything the night before. Like I said, like you're saying with your babysitting and all that, I've got to do all that too. So I want to feel like I'm going down. If it again, depends on the promotion. See, if you know you're going down, there's going to be hundreds of people. I'm there. If it's one where you go, oh, I don't know, like, because I've done a couple of these pop-up ones. Well, we're running my first company, we'd love you to be part of it, and that, and you negotiate it, and you get down, and you're going, I can count the people in the crowd here, right, in the ring, you know? And it has happened. I'd done a show once where I was in a match with 18 wrestlers. There was 18 people in a match, and there was 11 people in the crowd.
Wow.
So, and to be honest, out of the 11 people, I think 4 of them were the people that brought the ring. So you're going, how is this even running? Like, but so I'm being selective on ones where I'm going to take me away for days and days at a time. So if I could do 50 plus this year, I'd be happy. 50 plus next year, I'd be happy. The year after that, I don't know if I'm going to keep going into 2026, 2027, but I'm not going to be one of these wrestlers to say, I'm away and then come back. Once I'm away, because my last match, this is coming off. And
that is the gimmick dead.
Exactly. And I will kill this gimmick. I will bury it in the ground. Particular landmarks I'm looking at just now is, I want to tell good stories just now. And that's how I can see Combat League. But because we have that basically repeat audience, it's the same crowd. They sell out every show. I think they sell out a season pass. So like you once you bought your ticket, you're in. And then you go, so we've got these five or six shows through that year to tell a story. So let's construct a really good story. The one I've got this year is going to be brilliant. The one I had last year was really, really good, but it was a bit chalk and change because I changed house and all that as well. But to know that I've got input on what I'm going to be doing in 3 or 4 shows' time and how I'm going to get there and how I'm going to commit it at the end is you kind of beat it. And there's not a lot of promotions where you get a chance to do that because we're telling a story for the people there. I'm not telling it for them online because you're not going to be able to follow a story unless you're physically there. So Combat League. I've always put it over when it was KFNS. I always put it over. And the big thing has always been the creativity. I actually get to create what I do. The promoter has input in everything like he always does and how things go. In fact, I've got a lot of input in how things have went up there and how things have added to it. But how my year's going to go, I'm excited to create something.
Right, so before I let you go, though, I want to know how it was like, because you were due to have a match with Tajiri. It became a tag team match. But what was it like working with Tajiri?
He worked for me all day. He kept speaking in Japanese, would not speak English to me, even when he speaks English. Until after the match. Then after the match, it was English. He was... Do you know why the match was changed? Like, do you know the story now?
No, I all I know is, I mean, it doesn't surprise me when I saw the match changed, but because, no. You know.
So, here's what happened. I turned up at the seminar that Tajiri's doing that day. I'm wrestling him that night. And when I turned up, he's getting two boys with him. What's the
Saito Brothers, is it?
It's Saito Brothers, right. So he's getting two big boys and Tajiri. And one of Saito Brothers says to me, Tajiri-san is injured. He's hurt his leg. and he was, limping on a leg. He said he's worried about the match tonight. And I said, and me being me, I just like, tell him not to worry about it. Like, we can do as much as he wants or as little as he wants. I said, I'll do everything around him that, to fill the gaps. And as the day went on and stuff, we turned up at the venue. TJ's like, I can't do a match. He's like, I throw kicks and I can't throw my leg. And he said, so what we did, we'll do a six-man tag. Me and the two boys against Lucha, and I think it was why I did the tag team champions at the time. And I was like, I'm a tag team champ. So I'd be two of the people. But anyway, it was like, we'll do a six-man. And the promoter was just like, the whole show's been buttering used to. It was myself. I was like, why don't we? You go out, do the introduction to the crowd, have the two boys attack me, I'll come out and make a save and we'll tag. TJ's like, yeah, good idea. So we does a match. Match was all right. If you watch a match back, you can't tell he's hot because we recover it, and like you would do if it was anybody else got hot in the ring. And then after it, he was like, he says to me, who trained you? And I was like, I trained at PBW. And he was like, you are a very good professional wrestler. That's what I think. But again, he picked up on something that I always like emphasise to people. He said I do the wee things really good. Like when I wasn't in the ring, I was trying to grab my opponent and stuff like that. The only thing I was down about it was I'd been wearing a white t-shirt the show leading up because I was wanting to wear it during the match and not have it look weird that I was wearing a white t-shirt. The point of the white t-shirt was to get misted.
Right.
So I wanted to end up with all the green or the red mist or whatever. So I ended up and never got misted. But working with, obviously you're working with, I got to work with three Japanese guys whose English wasn't great. I kind of led the match for basically all three of us in the ring. And he ended it. Tajiri was happy. He got through a match. Nobody picked up the fact that he had an injury. And the crowd got to see the mist. And it was like kind of wee notch on my belt that we had an import come in and I managed to take the import through the match. Whereas 9 times out of 10, you go like a big name comes in and goes, like, don't worry about it, kid, I'll do everything, just you kind of stay aside and I'll do all my stick. But we still got all his points in the Tajiri elbow, because obviously he was hot. And I said to him, I did that move. And he said to me, you can have. So now I said to him, when Tajiri does matches, I said, he has to tell people he does a Lucha elbow. It's not Tajiri elbow anymore. But no, it was amazing. I spent the day with him. I took him to Stirling Castle before it. He went to see a castle. And I took him up, and then when he got there, he was very tired and stayed in the car. mate, it was bizarre. And then, like I said, after it, when he started talking English and we were joking with his book and stuff, it was a really good experience for me, wrestling wise. And then later on that night, dropped him off at a hotel. I'd already dropped the boys off; they were staying somewhere else. Sat and talked to him for a wee bit, and he was like, "You want to come in for a drink?" I said, "I've got an app." You're driving, mate, I can't. And then when I get down the road, I open my phone and the wee Tajiri now follows you on Twitter. And I was like, there you go. That's all you need. Worth it.
So we've kind of started the episode talking about something that's cool, but you weren't a fan of it, which is going to the WWE Network. You weren't happy with the match. And we've ended the episode with something that's cool and it's one of your favourite things. Relationship with Tajiri.
Yeah. And that year for wrestling came back, I hung about with Scotty Too Hot and Tajiri backstage at shows. And got to kind of pick their wrestling brain and show off a wee bit some of the stuff I could do. Scotty Too Hot, didn't follow me on Twitter. He deleted his Twitter.
I don't want to show off, but before he before he deleted his Twitter, he followed me on Twitter. So.
Who did he?
He did.
He followed you?
He followed me on Twitter, and then like 3 days later, he deleted it. So I don't know if he enjoyed the content I was putting out or what.
Mate, you know what? We should all just delete our Twitters. Everybody, that's the advice. The advice of the day: delete your Twitter. It's absolutely toxic.
I would agree, but that's where most of my traffic comes from. So don't. Everyone follow.
Does it really?
Instead. Yeah, most of it's Twitter because I don't like using Facebook because now if you run a page, you've got to have a separate app, and it's just a pain in the arse now to do it. So I
Twitter. What about Instagram? Do you not get loads of hits off that as well for the stories and stuff?
I don't know how to use Instagram very well, to be honest with you. I'll do a story if I remember. But really, all my traffic's Twitter. Really, that's where I kind of have market the
do
most.
You know what you should do? See, because we're talking business, this is what you should do, right? Or if I was you, you're right. The Scottish Wrestling Network, right? You support Scottish Wrestling. You post all their posters. You post all their pages. You should be having all these promotions up for a fee. Maybe that, no, mate, I'm being serious. If it was me, I would say it's so much a month, a year, whatever, to be part of the network. I will share all your posters and promote all your matches, your match graphics and that. Mm-hmm. And we'd throw you a couple of quid. And you don't even need to shave your pubes or anything.
I mean, I've got, right, for anyone who's heard that, I've got a Patreon. So if you want to go to patreon.com/scottresnet, it's £1 plus VAT. That's it. A month. Done. That's it. You get everything. Well, you get all
I would charge way more.
I know. Maybe
100% more. That having a wee fee for these promotions, it would give you an income plus it trims the fat out of ones that don't want to be part of it because you know how much stuff you share. Mm. I see how much you share every match graphic, promotion, announcement. And I will notice that the wrestlers even on the graphic won't even share it. And you're like, come on, mate, play ball a wee bit. Yeah. Like, it's not up to you to promote everybody's content that doesn't want to promote themselves.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, I'll probably say it after we record because I know that you've been paid. But anyway, right.
Make money.
Where can people find you on the interweb then? Where can people find it?
Everything's Lucha DS. Twitter Lucha DS, Instagram Twitter DS, Facebook Twitter DS, and hopefully soon the website. I was talking to a guy last night about running it and stuff, and they all want to know like how much is it going to generate, blah blah blah. And I'm like, no, it's just to point people in the direction of where they get stuff. That's all it is.
Just set up a WordPress. That's all my site is. It's a WordPress, and I'm not technologically minded. I am absolutely dog shit, all that kind of stuff. Editing, I don't edit these. I put a top and tail, I put it onto Anchor and YouTube. That's it. I do very little. And
my trick is I want to just make it and then not even do it again. I just pay somebody a couple of quid a month and they just go, it's updated, it's updated, it's updated. And I'm like, fine.
If it's as simple as a link in a poster, we can talk business. I can do that.
Yeah, I'm saying, there you go. I said, make money, Billy, and already you've got a business opportunity coming my way, yeah?
That's it. Right. We'll wrap up the episode. Thank you very much for this catch-up. I've enjoyed it. I know we could probably speak for hours about way too many things and go on to tangents and possibly, like I say, your emails would be, your junk email would be full of cease and desist.
I know. And then I was like, actually, I wonder if he's going to ask me what I thought of Royal Rumble. Is that MDK?
Oh. There's other podcasts that'll do that. I don't care about that. I watched it.
No, Billy, cheers, mate. Like I said, cheers for all your support of the wrestling community. Not everybody's a big fan of your posts all the time. You need to create posters and t-shirts. But not like I said, mate, you at least you keep the content for the group chats alive and everybody's all like, did you see the reply to Billy's post?
Everyone should go check out the SWN 100. That's it.
Oh, mate, we could have spoke for a. You could do a full episode on that list. Everybody going by a Red Poles t-shirt. There you go.
That's the one. That's the plug at the end. Perfect. Well.